Samuel Coleridge Taylor was born in London in 1875. His parents were Alice Hare Martin and Dr. Daniel Taylor. While his mother was British, his father hailed from Freetown in Sierra Leone. Like many of his fellow countrymen, Dr. Taylor had come to Britain in pursuit of an education. He met Alice in London, but appears to have returned to West Africa without knowing that she was pregnant. Unfortunately, Dr. Taylor would never end up being a part of Samuel's life. The young Coleridge Taylor was raised by Alice and her family in Croydon on the outskirts of London. In the 1880s, Samuel was given his first violin by his grandfather, who also taught him how to play. The youngster soon displayed a great aptitude for music and joined a local church choir. It was this church where Samuel was noticed by a wealthy choir master who encouraged him to apply for a place at the Royal College of Music in South Kensington. Samuel Coleridge Taylor joined the Royal College of Music in 1890. He was one of the first black students at the college. An earlier black student was Amanda Aldridge, who was the daughter of celebrated African-American actor Ira Aldridge. Samuel was awarded a scholarship for the violin. However, he was soon drawn towards composition instead. He went on to study under the composer and conductor Charles Vier Stanford. Several of the young composer's works were performed at the college, and he soon gained attention from prominent musical figures, including George Grove. While it is not clear when Samuel first became involved with black political issues in London, the first evidence of his involvement is a poem he wrote celebrating a half century of Liberian independence from European colonialists. A Liberian patriotic hymn was published in the African Times in March 1897. It included the opening lines, "Beloved Liberians, now from bondage free, may God our strength your motto, and your hope forever be." Documents held at the Royal College of Music Museum reveal that Coleridge Taylor was later made a Knight Official of the Liberian Humane Order of African Redemption. This is the highest decoration the Liberian government can bestow. Shortly after his Liberian patriotic hymn was published, Coleridge Taylor became a part of a network of influential African Americans. These included the poet, novelist, and playwright Paul Laurence Dunbar, who famously coined the line, "I know why the caged bird sings." When the young composer heard that this celebrated poet was in London, he went to the house where he was staying and asked for permission to set some of his poems to music. Dunbar agreed, and Coleridge Taylor's African Romances were published later that same year. In June of 1897, Coleridge Taylor and Dunbar gave a joint recital in London, attended by many influential American expats. This was reviewed by The Times, who said, "It was a pity that the recital given by these two colored gentlemen was not more widely known." Coleridge Taylor and Dunbar later collaborated on an operatic romance entitled Dream Lovers. This was performed in Croydon in 1898. Samuel Coleridge Taylor would become best known for his trilogy of cantatas, collectively known as the Song of Hiawatha. These were based on Henry Wadsworth Longfellow's famous poem of the same name, published in 1855, which relates the adventures of Native American hero called Hiawatha and his love, Minnehaha. Towards the end of Longfellow's poem, European missionaries arrive in order to convert Hiawatha's people to Christianity. This element of the narrative resonated with the experience of African Americans. Coleridge Taylor much admired Longfellow's Hiawatha and felt a close affinity with its hero. Perhaps this was because Hiawatha spends part of the poem searching for his absent father, who had abandoned his mother, much like Coleridge Taylor's own father had done. The composer also imagined himself and his white British fiancée, Jessie, as Hiawatha and Minnehaha. Jessie was a pianist who had also been a student at the Royal College of Music. Her family had initially objected to her marriage on account of Coleridge Taylor's mixed race. The couple went on to have two children. Their daughter, Gwendolyn, who later changed her name to Averill, was also a conductor, composer, and pianist. Coleridge Taylor named his son Hiawatha. Known as Watha amongst his family, he went on to conduct performances of his father's works. The Song of Hiawatha proved to be a huge success. Coleridge Taylor soon became a celebrity. Hiawatha was performed by choral societies across the country, often conducted by Coleridge Taylor himself. Copies of sheet music from various arrangements were sold widely, though the composer profited very little from these sales. In the year 1900, Samuel Coleridge Taylor was a leading delegate at the first Pan-African Conference in London. He took responsibility for arranging musical entertainments. Historians have subsequently referred to this important meeting as one of the starting points for the Afrocentrism that constituted an important strand of the American Civil Rights Movement 60 years later. Many prominent Black civil rights leaders, politicians, and educators were in attendance. Amongst the most important delegates was W.E.B. Du Bois, an activist, writer, sociologist, and historian who was a key proponent of Pan-Africanism. Coleridge Taylor was involved with several other Pan-African groups at around this time, including the United African League in 1902. As Coleridge Taylor came to prominence in Britain, African Americans were suffering from one of the worst periods of political, social, cultural, and economic repression they had experienced since the Civil War. In this context, the success of a Black composer across the Atlantic captured the imagination of many. Coleridge Taylor was celebrated as an example of what could be possible for Black people. He became a symbol of hope. When the composer first visited the U.S. in 1904, he was treated as a major celebrity. He conducted performances of his music given by a choir formed in his name, and became the first Black man to conduct a white orchestra. In 1905, Coleridge Taylor's 24 Negro Melodies were published. This collection of African and African American songs were presented by the composer as a collection of folk music. In the introduction to this work, he boldly stated, "What Brahms has done for the Hungarian folk music, Dvorak for Bohemian, and Grieg for Norwegian, I have tried to do for Negro Melodies." This work represented an attempt to change attitudes towards Black music, rescuing its reputation from the dehumanizing coon songs and minstrel shows which were so popular in contemporary Britain and America. In America, Coleridge Taylor's reputation was much strengthened by the support of white virtuoso violinist Maud Powell. One of the first great artists of the recording era, Powell recorded a version of Coleridge Taylor's Deep River from 24 Negro Melodies. This would become exceptionally popular. She later described it as her best-selling recording. Maud Powell was an ardent supporter of the African American music and performed to raise funds for the education of Black musicians. In 1906, Coleridge Taylor's Symphonic Variations on an African Air was performed for the first time. This was based on the theme of an African-American spiritual. Musicologists have described this work as representing an understanding of the conditions of Black history. In 1912, Samuel Coleridge Taylor died suddenly and unexpectedly. He became ill while on a train and died of pneumonia a few days later. There was a national outpouring of grief over his death. Huge crowds attended Coleridge Taylor's funeral in South London. A memorial concert was held for Taylor at the Royal Albert Hall, with proceeds going to his young family. Many were appalled at the way in which he had profited very little from the extraordinary success of his works, leaving meager funds behind him. This outrage led to the establishment of the Performing Rights Society. Until World War II, Hiawatha would remain one of the most performed choral pieces in Britain. Its popularity was rivaled only by Handel's Messiah and Mendelssohn's Elijah. The Song of Hiawatha also achieved success around the globe. In 2013, an impressive feature-length documentary about Samuel Coleridge Taylor was produced by the Longfellow Chorus in Maine. It focuses on the composer's important relationship with America. Samuel Coleridge Taylor is typically remembered because of his unusual and important status as a Black musician who gained prominence in late Victorian and Edwardian Britain. He was also an extremely important figure within Black networks. He was not only an extraordinarily talented musician, but a pioneer and advocate for Black culture whose influence was felt far beyond the musical sphere.